Hi everyone, Dennis Foley from Acoustic Fields. Today we're going to talk about wave and ray energy. People are still not understanding the difference, and understanding the difference between these two kinds of energies is crucial to room acoustics. So if you don't get this basic premise and paradigm, you're going to be lost. So I'm going to try another approach here and hope that we get more comprehension and understanding. So we have to think of wave energy as low frequency energy. Now I want you to visualize ocean waves. You're sitting on the beach, you're watching these waves roll constantly out of the water onto the beach in a cycle, okay? That's low frequency pressure in your room. So visualize that when you're sitting in your room. Visualize a series of pressure waves throughout the room. And inside these pressure waves, you're either going to hear too much energy, too much frequency, or nothing at all. Those are called room modes. It's the wave pressure that generates the modal structure of the room and the dimensions. The dimensions first, then the pressure, then the modes. Okay? So wave energy is pressure. It has long wavelengths, big tails, wide widths, wide heights. It's the elephant in the room when it comes to room acoustics. Low frequency energy does not want to be contained in a box. It wants to run free. We set up a driver one time, and I wish I had the video, but we can't seem to find it. Open field, low frequency driver, 350 yards, we were able to measure those long 40, 50 cycle waves generating two. They go a long way. I just did a video called 28 Story Bass. Watch that one when it comes up. You'll get the idea. Okay, ray energy is different. Ray energy, we want to think of that as sunshine. Straight, thin, short. Where wave energy is long, tall, and wide. Say fat if you want to, okay? Different types of energy in your room. They both produce different problems, and they can't be treated with the same treatment. So we have to look at the treatment, the differences in treatment. So let's think of a speaker. What is a speaker? It's a diaphragm that moves in and out. That's what creates sound. That's what creates our music. It's the electromechanical movement of a driver, right? So it's a diaphragm. It moves and it creates sounds. It generates low, mids, and high frequencies. Full range, most speakers, you know. Monitors, shelf speakers, not so much. They don't go as low, but that's by design. But a full range speaker is going to produce all the frequency response we need for the room. So we have a diaphragm that's producing the sound energy. So let's use a diaphragm to absorb it. And that's what diaphragmatic absorption is. It's a diaphragm. When we build our cabinets, we have two front walls. So when the wave pressure hits those two front walls, which are out of phase, they get slowed down. Then it enters the inside of the cabinet with our carbon technology. And it's a lower atmospheric pressure inside the cabinet because we use 60, 65 pounds of carbon to create that lower pressure inside. So when the wave enters the cabinet, it's created in one atmosphere, and it goes into another, it collapses. We call it cutting off the head and the tail. I don't know how accurate that description is, but I think you get the idea. Attenuation. So diaphragmatic, it's the most powerful, and it absorbs at the lowest frequency range. So that's what we need to treat wave energy, those oceans. We need to construct a big diaphragm to stop that kind of movement. Diaphragmatic is the most powerful of all three types. Let's review the three types: Helmholtz, membrane, and diaphragmatic. Helmholtz, frequency specific. You need a lot of them. They're good fine-tuning mechanisms, but they're not good for overall absorption. Membrane, a cousin of diaphragmatic, works in the same principle, can go low, but doesn't get enough. So you need a lot of them again. So Helmholtz and membrane, you need lots of them. Broadband diaphragmatic absorption is the way to go. One unit that can handle all the energy and do it in a very good fashion. Get a lot of strength there. What are we trying to do in our room? We're trying to create a frequency response friendly environment, because our room is not. And the music that comes out of the speakers, it's going to dance with the room. And we don't want it to. We just want it to be music. So hope this kind of helps you out here, because I'm seeing a lot of and getting a lot of calls and people describing technologies that have no chance of working. And that's got to be frustrating. I talked to a client the other day, spent $9,000 on boxes filled with building insulation, and he hates the low end of his room. So that should tell you something right there. We get calls like that every day. My standard response is, and it's not a smart-ass response, I'm trying to get to the truth. Why are you calling us? You just spent $9,000. Your problem should be solved. It's not solved. In fact, it's only beginning. And now their bank account's drained $9,000. So diaphragmatic is the most powerful of all. And you need the most powerful if you're going to stop energy that's very long, very tall, and very wide, and very strong. We see plus 10, plus 12, plus 15, plus 16 dB peaks in room response. Big peaks and then big dives. You got to stop both, but you got to start with the peaks first. And only diaphragmatic has that kind of horsepower. Wave and ray energy. Hope this helps. Thank you. Thank you for watching this video. And if you liked it, please give us a thumbs up. We also have a newsletter that you can subscribe to, so please do that, because we offer special price discounts to only those on our newsletter. And then don't forget about our forum. We have started a forum on our own website where people ask questions, and I usually get a chance every couple days to look at it. There's an interchange between people on the forum, and we'll give you real answers on a regular basis, so that'll help you. Thank you.